We make judgments of other people that aren't like us. Perhaps they behave differently, think differently, believe differently, or perceive the world differently. In those situations, it's so easy to think, who are those people? Or even, what's wrong with those people? I'm going to give us a fresh take on answering the age-old question, who are those people? It's a pertinent question for us today. I am. Two of the most powerful words a self-differentiated individual can speak. I am, the words we use to claim our divine nature. I am a unity minister because I believe in the principles we teach. I believe we co-create our world. I believe that we are divinity having a human experience and that we are powerful beings. Right now, you and I have co-created this moment for us to be together. We have something powerful to share with each other in this present moment. Now, when I first heard that call, I'm not going to lie to you and tell you that when God whispered in my ear, Shree, you will be a unity minister. I'm not going to tell you I said yippee because I didn't. Nope. In my human wisdom, I ran for about another 20 years. I had all these rational thoughts that contradicted my divine truth, my life purpose. You see, I believed I wasn't worthy enough. I believed that I was without power to manifest a world that can work for all beings. As you and I know, life has a way of helping us to have experiences that shift us. As life shifted me, grew me, awakened me, I finally understood the truth of what I am. I am God manifesting. And guess what? You are God manifesting. It's one of our sacred tenets. So imagine my surprise when I have the thought, who are those people? Followed up immediately by the next thought, which says, what's wrong with those people? This is not a moment to shy away from because it's a wonderful moment. First, I realize I have a thought, and then I realize that that thought is out of alignment with my belief, out of alignment with truth. You see, a minister that is doing their own work is unafraid to share all aspects of their humanity and divinity. For me, being a minister means I'm willing to be authentic, willing to share my foibles, my aha moments, as well as my uh-oh moments. Because in my journey, I've come to realize that being of God means I am all things. Metaphysically, I am the Savior, and I am the one to be saved. As humans, we are all of the human archetypes. Well, what's an archetype? An archetype is defined as the collectively inherited unconscious idea or a pattern of thought or images that are universally present in individual psyches. That sounds like a mouthful, doesn't it? But often we identify ourselves as only one thing, like being the hero, or the villain, right? The mother or the child. Yet the reality is we have all aspects of the archetypes within our psyche. Most of us want to be good people, but we often do so by hiding the aspects of ourselves that we don't really like. And then those hidden aspects we project onto the world. For example, if I try to hide the aspect of me that is judgmental, because I don't particularly like that that's a part of me, guess what? Energetically, the suppression of that energy, right, spurts out into me seeing it in others. Of course, it's no surprise to me then that I have the thought, what's wrong with those people, right? Let's call it what it is. It's not about really who are those people, but it's really the focus is what's wrong with those people. Now, as a unity practitioner, I get to unravel where this thought comes from. That's part of what practical spirituality is about, being fearless in self-awareness. This thought came from my observing what's happening right now culturally in our country. One doesn't have to be a scholar to realize that the systems that we as a society put in place to help us, to serve us, to protect us, well, they aren't working the way that they should in theory. Right? Let's look at our healthcare system, the criminal justice system, or politics, right? None of them are working the way that they were intended to work. And then we try to fix that. So in our attempt to fix these systems, right, what do? We vote and implement new laws that support these broken systems. Then when those new laws still don't work or still don't fix the broken systems, it's easy to say it's those folks, you know, those folks over there that are causing the issues. It brings to mind a famous quote that I love by Albert Einstein. Problems cannot be solved with the same mindset that created them. What it will take to solve the problem is an awakened consciousness, right? It's going to take an awakened consciousness to solve the problems. Today, we live in a culture where people speak from their belief system as if it is truth. It's human nature to think that what I believe must be true. Often that belief isn't truth, but a myth we have come to believe as truth. And when this happens, it creates dissonance. So let me share with you the definition of dissonance by Merriam-Webster. And there it is. Dissonance is a tension or a clash resulting from the combination of two disharmonious or unsuitable elements. Right? It's a lack of agreement, the dissonance between the truth and what people want to believe. Especially, there's an inconsistency between the beliefs one holds or between one's actions and one's belief, right? So what's an example of dissonance? An example of dissonance would be, let's say, we have the belief that we are to love our brothers and sisters as ourselves, right? Which really means I am my brother and sister's keeper. What's the action? Let's say we see homelessness. So we choose not to create systems to eradicate the epidemic of homelessness and poverty of those who are less fortunate. Maybe we think, well, it's their fault that they're in that situation. So that's dissonance. Now let's talk about cognitive dissonance. There it is. So I want to define cognitive dissonance because what we are feeling in our culture right now has a lot to do with dissonance. Again, the dictionary defines cognitive dissonance as the psychological conflict resulting from incongruous beliefs and attitudes held simultaneously. Ooh, that's a mouthful. So let's talk about that in a real world example. I'll give you an example of cognitive dissonance. Once again, the belief, we'll stay with that belief, to love our brothers and sisters as ourselves, which we know means I am my brother or sister's keeper. So we have the attitude. Well, if they got a job, there wouldn't be this problem, right? So we know that we are our brother and sister's keeper. But when we see homelessness or poverty, we may have this attitude that if they got a job, there wouldn't be this problem. And the psychological conflict that that creates is feelings within our bodies. And the feelings can vary from anger, right? If be in this conflict, could be resentment. I don't want to feel this way being my brother's keeper when I'm trying to stay afloat myself. Could be apathy, that we're stuck doing nothing because we just feel overwhelmed. And we could even feel fearful, knowing that it could be us, that each of us, for the most part in the US, we are two paychecks away from being homeless. And then who would help us? right? And all of that psychological confliction impacts our body. There is a physical uncomfortability when we feel dissonance, and that can be resonating in our bodies as agitation, stress, insomnia, panic attacks, illnesses, and all the like, right? Okay. And we see that debate going on in our society right now, right? We see it in the debates in our society today. We have Christians, spiritual people, religious folks who follow our way-showers tenet, right? Do unto others as you would have them do unto you. And that's from Luke chapter 6, verse 31. But for some, they've decided that the rule only applies to those who fall into the accepted norms of their worldview of society, right? So, it's not applicable here to, let's say, same-sex marriage. They may believe that that is not in accordance with their world perception of how people should be. So there are Christians who won't acknowledge gay marriages. There are actually Christians and spiritual people who see any person of color as less than human or worthless. This is seen recently in our treatment of immigrant children who are escaping, you know, death, poverty, persecution, and they're being held in cages. We may not be hearing about it right now, but that's still going on, being impacted severely by the coronavirus. And then there are those who are spiritual Christian that are also in acceptance of the treatment of Black lives, the treatment of Black lives as disposable, not of value, basically legalized slavery, which is known as our prison systems, has raised the current alarm that we have with the Black Lives Matter movement. Dissonance is having the belief of loving our brother as ourselves while behaving with violence to them, or having any thought that separates us from each other. We all have these stories we tell ourselves to reduce our feelings of dissonance. Cognitive dissonance was first investigated by Leon Festinger, arising out of a participant observation study of a cult which believed that the earth was going to be destroyed by a flood, and what happened to its members when that didn't occur, particularly the really committed ones who had given up their homes and jobs to work for the cult when the flood did not happen. While fringe members were more inclined to recognize that they had made fools of themselves and to put it down to experience, the committed members were more likely to reinterpret the evidence to show that they were right all along. You see, the earth wasn't destroyed because of our faithfulness, because of the faithfulness of the cult members. Overcoming cognitive dissonance occurs by taking actions in one of these ways. We can trivialize the inconsistency. We can add a thought, change behavior, change thought, or through spiritual practices, we can shift being in cognitive dissonance. We want to change this feeling of cognitive dissonance because of the physical impact of that uncomfortability I mentioned earlier, right? That we feel in our bodies that makes us feel ill. Now, I've written a book, Turning Your Why Into Why Not, and on page 67 in that book, there is a worksheet that you can use to work through your feelings of cognitive dissonance. Now, in our example, we're having the belief right here, when I had that thought, who are those people, followed by what's wrong with those people, right? So the belief that I have is each of us is God manifesting, right? That's my belief. Each of us is God manifesting. And then I have this thought, right, which is a judgment about what's wrong with those people. And so what that creates within me is cognitive dissonance, right? I have a belief, and then I have a thought that is in conflict. Now, if I worked through the cognitive behavioral way of making peace with cognitive dissonance, the choices I have are, as I mentioned, trivializing the inconsistency, right? And maybe I could say something to myself like, well, if they would just pull up their bootstraps and worked hard, then there wouldn't be these problems. Or I could add a thought, and the thought could be something like, what would my life be if I walked in that person's shoes? Or, and I could change a behavior. I could get to know people who aren't like me. Or I could choose to change a thought. Like maybe the new thought would be, there's nothing wrong with those people. They are of God. So that's the cognitive behavioral way of shifting out of cognitive dissonance. What I want to focus on with you is the spiritual practices, going through that process with you. So how do we do it spiritually? In Unity, we have our own method of being able to reduce dissonance. Guess what they're called? They are the five Unity principles. So I have a thought, right? What's wrong with those people? And that creates that dissonance within me. So how do we resolve that? Let me remind you what the five Unity principles are. These are the five Unity principles. I have the thought, what's wrong with those people? So I go to my first principle. There is only one presence and one power active as the universe and as my life, God the good. So I have the thought, what's wrong with those people? I could kind of go, well, perhaps God had a day off or an off day when this person was created, right? Yeah, maybe God had an off day. But I continue working through my principles. The second one is, our essence is of God, therefore we are inherently good. This God essence, called the Christ, was fully expressed as Jesus. Well, I can go, aha, to myself, their behavior doesn't reflect the Christ consciousness, so how can they be of God? So we work through that process, and we get to the third one. We are co-creators with God, creating reality through thoughts held in mind. Oh, here we go. Well, if I'm holding the thought that there is a wrong person, that person is wrong, I got to tell you, I don't want to co-create any more wrong people in my life. And here starts that shift, right? Then we go to number four. Through prayer and meditation, we align our heart, mind with God. Denials and affirmations are tools that we use. So now I'm working here. So I'm going to start with denials, and I'm going to say, there is nothing wrong with this person. There's nothing wrong with those people. And the affirmation I may use is, they are of God. And then I go into prayer. And in prayer, I ask the question, how can I see God within those folks? How can I see God within them? And then I go into meditation. Right into that stillness, and I wait to hear my answer. And maybe that answer that I get then says, they forgot the truth of who they are. They forgot that they are divine human being. Wow, now there's something I can do. I get to step five of this process, and it says, through thoughts, words, and actions, we live the truth we know. So what's the truth? I know that they are divine, and maybe they forgot that truth. So knowing this truth, I now get to show up with compassion and empathy. I am then able to treat them as a being of God. as I remind them now of their truth. That is where transformation happens. You see, in unity, we practice practical spirituality because we know we can change the world and that it starts with each of us, with each of us. So this week, I'm going to ask you to become mindful of any thoughts that occur that separates you from others. And as those thoughts come up, don't judge them. Simply know you are having a human experience and love that piece of yourself. We are here to love all of ourselves and integrate that for wholeness. You are an aspect of that which you separate from. Do you hear me? You are a piece of that aspect which you separate from. So I'm inviting you to be fearless in your self-awareness. Hold yourself accountable to the five principles. And I'm betting that you will be able to shift from that belief of us versus them to they are of God. They are divine. And how do I show up with them as another divine human being here to help them remember their truth? Thank you. So, I hope that you found there to be helpful tips that you can utilize as we navigate this time in our culture where there is so much division. So if you want to support this beautiful spiritual community, you can go to unityofspringfieldillinois.org. There's a donate button there. There was also a donate button in the email that you received about today's service. And I believe Chris is putting something in the chat box as well. It's so important to support your spiritual communities, as Christine has done such an amazing job of still trying to keep you connected and inspired during this time of isolation, right? And so let's just take a moment of gratitude for how you support this community, knowing that Spirit fills you with complete abundance and transformation for everything that you give. And no matter what you give, it's impossible for you to outshare, outgive God's abundance and love. And so we just take a moment of gratitude for each of you as you support this community in love, in talent, in tithes. And we see you being blessed beyond your imagination. Amen. So thank you everyone for joining us, and please continue to invite friends and family to join us on Sundays. Let's spread the word. Let's not keep unity as this secret. The world needs unity and unity's principles more now than ever. So share it. And if you'd like to join me in the prayer for protection, we can say this together. The light of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is. And all is well.